Excuse the band sound checking in the background. I speak to you from a family-friendly resort, difficult enough to find a location with none of those pesky little vlog-bombing blighters in the background. But Mondays wait for no man, even on a family holiday. Yes, it is another. Interesting comments last week, a slight polarisation I'm detecting with this, you know, when is it going to stop sounding like kind of cheap 2D synths and, you know, what's wrong with your fuckbox? Doesn't that just work as well as, you know, the effects and stuff like that? Well, I think it's very interesting because, you know, I think with the fuckbox and my analog synths, there's a space in the middle and that is modular. And I'll give you three reasons for that. First is the environment. Now, criticizing modular synthesis and the way it works and you can't save patches and all of that kind of stuff is akin to criticizing someone for using, say, Ableton Live because the notation package is crap. You know, I don't lie awake thinking about how I'm going to program one of my analog synths. I don't lie awake thinking how I'm going to kind of join up my guitar pedals. But I do lay awake at night thinking about the modular system and how you can get controllers to control everything, which is something I believe Sandy is going to get onto momentarily. And that leads me on to my second point, which is I can't get my analog synths to control my guitar pedals or my fuckbox, and I certainly can't get my fuckbox to control my analog synths. The modular system is a self-contained universe where voltages rule supreme and anything can control anything else. And the third reason is my fascination in this kind of semi-autonomous unit. I want to create a slightly chaotic Frankensynth. And I know I've been criticized for that because Frankenstein's monster wasn't called Frankenstein. I'm going to call him Fergal. So with this in mind, I wanted to this week introduce the pulsing heart of Fergal in the shape of an Intellijel Metropolis step sequencer, which I'm adding into my rack here. But first, I really want to do some housework, and I believe I have some words of encouragement from New England.
Hi, Christian. Sandy here, hopefully coming to you in glorious high definition this time. This week, I'm not going to dive too much into the DIY project. I think I'll save that for another video where we can go really in-depth once I start soldering this thing. So for this week, I thought I would look a little bit more at VCV rack and use that to explain a sort of concept that's been bumping around in my head the last couple of weeks. We've had a lot of comments about layout of your case, and a lot of people have got, you know, a fairly good idea that doing a sort of left to right or right to left, so you've got a sensible, obvious signal path or chain going through that, which is a perfectly valid approach. But with modular synthesis, I suppose the beauty is that you can arrange the case really however you like. And I know a few people who use modular who say that their sort of spring cleaning and rearranging their modules gives them a whole bunch of new inspiration as it sort of changes up their approach.
Okay, I'm going to pause you there, Sandy. I want to basically have a quick tidy of my rack and set it up with a system that kind of works for me in my head, with a signal flow working left to right. So the first row is kind of going to be like my keyboard, the controllers. In this case, the first thing going in is the sequencer. The second row is going to be this kind of sound makers and shakers. Third row is going to be the sound changers, the effects, the reverbs, echoes, distortions. And the fourth row is going to be utilities. Right, light, camera, fractions. Let's get down to business with the Intellijel Metropolis. Okay, so let's put our favorite oscillator into the VCA and the VCA into our output. Let's connect the gate out of the Metropolis into the gate in on the VCA. Then the pitch out of the Metropolis to the pitch in on the oscillator. This is a step sequencer, so each pulse or step you're hearing has pitch control here. Now beneath each pitch slider is a pulse count slider. This controls how many pulses you want per step. I've changed the first step to 2. We have an unsquare sequence of 9 notes, so I'm going to reduce the number of steps to 7, and with the first step having 2 pulses or notes, this makes a tidy 8. This knob changes the pulse or gate length, and beneath the pulse counters are gate controls, which determine whether it plays the pulse counts as separate pulses, or as a single short pulse with a rest, or just a rest for the length of the 2 pulses, or one longer pulse. Now here's me shaping the envelope of each pulse with the Make Noise Maths unit. Here's me reducing the tempo down to a more respectful 105 BPM, and I figured this out without having to RTFM. I'm then routing the LFO bit of maths into the cutoff control of the LPF, and hey presto. Which takes me back to my original point. Modular synthesis isn't about the kind of comparative functionality of, say, a modular synth versus an analog synth. It is all about control, something that I think Sandy picks up on here.
So, I mean, we've been looking at envelope generators and low-frequency oscillators and VCAs and VCOs so far. And generally speaking, we've looked at those in terms of a sort of traditional analog signal path, which is perfectly valid, and it's how you approach things that you're new to. So we've looked at envelope generators generally in terms of controlling the shape of the volume of our sound, describing the volume curve, or we've looked at it in terms of opening and closing filters. And the same again with our low frequency oscillator and our VCA. We've looked at those in terms of how we would use them to make a sort of traditional analog voice for a synthesizer. I think when things get very interesting though is when you realize that all of these different modulation sources, your envelopes, your LFOs, your sequencers, are all really outputting the same material, which is your voltage, your control voltage. And anything that can take control voltage can be modulated by one of these sources. So you could have your sequencer controlling filter cutoff, and an envelope controlling pitch, and your LFO controlling your amplitude of your sound. So you'll get a completely, you know, off-kilter sequenced sound. It won't sound really anything like a traditional analog voice. That's one thing I wanted to look at in VCB Rack, which we'll jump into in a second. Things get very interesting when you start modulating your modulation. One LFO can make a sound quite interesting, but two LFOs can make the same sound vastly more organic and unusual and unpredictable sounding, just by doing something like using one LFO, say a sine wave, to control the frequency of another. You get something that's still sort of undulating back and forth, but it has a little bit more of a non-linear or unusual kind of unexpected behavior. And the more modulation you add into that system, the more complex and maybe subtle and interesting it can become. So let's jump into VCB Rack. And we'll have a little look at a couple of patches that I put together to sort of look at how you might approach sort of modulating your modulation or some more unusual or novel approaches to modulation. Okay, so this is a reasonably complicated looking patch on the surface, but actually it's quite simple really. We've got a single voltage controlled oscillator in the middle here, two VCAs, a voltage controlled filter, and that which is outputting its low pass output into our mixer and then on out to our outputs. We've got a single note coming in from Ableton this time. And in fact, I'm not even using any pitch particularly. This is just going to be a single pitch just to demonstrate this. But I do have that gate being split out into several different locations. Now, you could do that with a passive multi-module or some stacking cables, or you could just use some kind of splitter module or something like that. The first of these two envelopes here, the one on the right, is doing what we've done before, and that is sending a envelope to our VCA to describe a volume curve for our oscillator. And you'll notice I'm taking the square wave output of the oscillator into that, just as you expect. But what we have going on after that is the output of this VCA is going into the input of the next VCA, and you'll see that that VCA is being opened by our LFO here. So this LFO is sending out a sawtooth wave. Normally would rise from zero to its full voltage and then drop back down quite immediately. I've flicked this little switch here to invert it. So what it's doing is starting at its top voltage and decaying, much like a little envelope of its own, like a repeating envelope. I've also got that resetting on a gate, so every time a note is triggered, that will start from the beginning of the envelope, as it were. So I'll let you hear what that sounds like. I'll just turn up the mixer here. It's almost like a delay effect. You've got one envelope, and then that envelope is sort of controlling or being fed through another envelope here. So far, so good. However, what I was talking about earlier about modulating your modulation, if I take the sine wave output of this LFO here and plug that into our FM1, now what we get is this pattern will speed up and slow down. And again, just for an extra bit of fun, I've decided to take a sine wave out of another LFO to frequency modulate this one. So this should give us a much more unpredictable sound. I've also got another ADSR envelope over here, which is just controlling our filter cutoff, but I could add another one, or I could have that controlling something like our pulse width modulation if we wanted to. What I'll do is I'll send a triangle wave from this slow LFO here into our pulse width modulation of our VCO, just for an extra little bit of flavor, a little bit of changing speed. So if I turn that up now with all of these things hooked up, you'll hear that there's sort of a sweet spot to be found where it kind of undulates and has an interesting sort of bouncing ball effect, but it isn't totally predictable because we've got these three LFOs and two of the three aren't synced to the note starting. So you can see just how quickly you can get these sort of unusual and undulating signals to be developed with really simple modulation. Anyway, back to you, Christian.
Thanks, Sandy. And yes, you do look rather resplendent in HD. Now, because I'm a bit of a slapper, if you recall, I actually have two kind of synthesizer units already in Fergal. So I'm going to use my first stacking cable to duplicate the stuff that Metropolis is sending out to these synths.
Stacking your ORAC patch cables, where each end has a male plug and female jack so you can mult signals without needing the space of a multiple.
So I'm sending the gate and pitch CVs via the stacking cables to two destinations now, my micro kind of modular synth and the all-in-one Intellijel Atlantis, which I'm then patching through into the second input of our LPF. Get them flush in tune with each other here. Then I'm going to patch in the LFO from the maths to an LFO on Atlantis, which is controlling a filter envelope. And hey presto, we have two different things generating very different outcomes. I think the whole purpose of this series is for me to learn about modular synths with you. So what I will say will often be full of mistakes, which hopefully you guys are correcting in the comments below. So if you are new to this series, do check the comments below for corrections in what I'm saying. The reason I'm investing my time in this modular setup is part of a major project that I hope to get off the ground later in the year, at which I think Fergal is going to be a central kind of beating heart to it. More of that soon. Next week, I'm going to be introducing these two bad boys, a delay module and a reverb module. And I hope to show you how it's quite extraordinary to have a reverb unit that is modulating an oscillator, but then is also controlling an oscillator or other aspects of the signal path. I'm also really in the market for a distortion unit and wondered if you had any recommendations regarding that. Thanks as always for watching. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do hit like if you like what I do, and ring that bell if you want to be notified about the next film.